Please, I go, even you two, don't do this with each other. Just get alone. Get alone with the Word of God. Pray to God and say, God, show me the truth of this book. Just open it. Read it from cover to cover. And what's the obvious translation of this? What's the obvious meaning of this? Because I don't believe you'd come up with your theology if you started with this book. It was the same thing I said to the Jehovah's Witnesses that came to my... I don't know why these people come to my door. They should just put me on a list, you know. And I'm going... I go, here's my problem with you. I said, Jesus, is Michael the archangel? He's just one of the chief princes? Jesus. And they go, no, not just one of them. He's the only. And I go, no, turn to Daniel 10. You know, Daniel 10, verse 13, it says, you know, Michael, one of the chief princes. So if this is Jesus, then Jesus, one of the chief princes. And they go, oh, I never saw that. And I go, look, it's not about a verse. It's not about this or that. I'm just telling you, you would never read this book and then put it down and go, I got it. Jesus is Michael. I go, you'd never come up with that. And I said, look, I don't want to stand at my doorstep and feed you a new theology. Would you please, just get alone. Don't listen to me. Don't listen to anything else I have to say. Because I don't want to feed you something else. And don't listen to anyone else that's feeding this stuff to you. Just get alone and believe in the Holy Spirit of God. Get on your knees and say, God, show me the truth of this book. And just when you're by yourself, I'm not even asking you to come to my house for Bible study. Just study the Bible by yourself, by the power of the Holy Spirit. Would you please consider this? And he says, you know what, I'll consider that. And I guess what I'm saying to you today is, would you consider that? Would you consider that? See, when I started my church, I knew what I needed. I needed a building. I needed a worship.
The Holy Spirit, and Peter's going, man, you see.
goes, repent and be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins, and you'll receive this Holy Spirit. You'll receive the Holy Spirit. This promise is for you and for your kids and for all those who are far off. You see, I would put the Bible down and go, wait, that's me. That's me. I'm one of those who's far off. You know what? Repent. I'm going to turn from the way I'm living, and I want to follow this Jesus now. I want him. I believe he died on that cross for my sins. I'm ready to follow him. I'm going to repent. I'm going to get baptized, die to my old self. I want this new life. I want this Spirit. I'm going to receive this Spirit because it was promised to me. That's what I would lead this. You know, sorry if I appear simple-minded to you, but to me, in my mind, that's just how it works. I just go, well, it seems like he said it'd be the same now, that Holy Spirit would come into me, and there'd be a difference, and then there would be a fruit to the Holy Spirit in my life, and there would be a noticeable difference between a person who is dead and another person who has the Holy Spirit inside of them. A noticeable difference. It wouldn't make sense that I have unbelieving neighbors who have more love, joy, peace, patience, kindness than the people inside my congregation. I would believe that the Holy Spirit would come into me, and he really could change me. And I'd be praying, okay, God, give me this Holy Spirit, because I can't get in front of any crowd. I can't lead anyone to the Lord. You said it's a Spirit that gives life, and the flesh is of no help at all. I can't do anything. I can't do anything. I need the Spirit. And if I have the Spirit, then everything's going to be fine. And if I don't, I'm screwed. I might not say that, but you know, it's just, I must have your Holy Spirit because this is what you've depended. That's the theology I would come up with. What would I believe about the church? What would I do if I started with Scripture? I mean, imagine coming off an island after reading the Scriptures over and over again, and now you were going to visit a church. What would you expect to see when you walked in? Or would you even expect to walk in? You know, what would you expect when you got together with other believers? What would you expect to see? I don't know about you, but even if there was a building, which is fine, there's nothing wrong with that. If I walked into a building where the church got together and it was a biblical church, what would you expect to see exegetically? I'd expect to see a group of people that were crazy about one another, loving one another, sharing their possessions with one another. Like, man, this is going to be one of those, man, getting off that island, I'm going to go to one of these places where there's no need with anyone because they love each other, they forgive each other, they pray for one another, they serve one another, they honor one another. I'm going to go to one of these places. I'm going to walk in, and I'm going to see this love, and I'm going to see this power amidst them, and everyone's going to have this sense of awe. Can you imagine the shock when you walked into a church? Wow. Where would we start? These are the things I want. I'm not giving you answers to, hey, you got to do it like this, 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 this. This is what we're going through as a church right now. Going, this doesn't make sense. A lot of this doesn't make sense biblically. It's okay that we meet together and I teach you the word of God, but we can't call that church. Church was this family. You know what really hit me? It was by a little over a year ago. This guy, you know, we do baptisms every service because I go, man, it just seemed like that's the way we're supposed to do it. Like they would just come and they were cut to the heart. And what do? Repent, be baptized. You know, so let's just do it every service. I remember this one guy, you know, because we border LA County, and this guy that had come out of the gangs, you know, all tatted up, Hispanic guy, and we get guys out of the prisons, whatever, you know. But you know, typically remember those guys. And I remember building a relationship with this guy, and just I loved his fire, loved his passion. And then he stopped coming for a while, and I don't really notice, because you know, sometimes you just don't notice. Certain people are gone, and someone came up to me and said, hey, remember that guy? And I'm like, oh, I do remember him. I go, where's he been? And he goes, well, I talked to him a little while ago. And I asked him, hey, how come? He goes, I don't go to Cornerstone anymore. And I asked him, why don't you go? And here's what the guy said. He goes, I had the wrong vision of church. He goes, I thought that when I got baptized and when I joined the church, he goes, I thought it was going to be like when I got jumped into the gang. He goes, when I got jumped into my gang, immediately we became family. They had my back 24 hours a day. If I'm sleeping in the street, they're sleeping in the street with me. You know, it was family. And it wasn't just once a week where we got together. He goes, it was all the time, man. They were my brothers. They were my sisters. I mean, real family. He goes, so I thought when I got, you know, joined the church that that's what it was going to become. I didn't know. He goes, I just didn't understand church. I don't know what that
church. He's like 20 years old, 23 years old. And he was just talking about everything he shared, about how the gangs are a better picture family and how these people are so committed they'll die for this thing. He goes, and you guys won't. And at the end of his message, he says, you know, he goes, you know, it's like, it's like Satan stole God's playbook, you know? And people are attracted to the gangs because they're doing things biblically. I mean, except for the killing part, but you know, it's just, but it's like they're attracted to that family, and it was so powerful. And I thought, but here's this uneducated average guy with this boldness laying it out. And I go, man, that's awesome. Learned so much from that. You know, as we've talked about this whole idea of, why don't you just disciple people? Why don't you counsel people? Why don't you talk to your neighbor about Christ and try to create these communities everywhere? The comments we hear back is, we know it's biblical, Francis, but you just can't pull it off in today's culture. And my answer to that is, have you forgotten who the Holy Spirit is? Are you kidding me? You're telling me that Jesus could look at 11 people and say, you're going to get the message to the whole world without internet access? Because this Spirit's going to be in you, and you can't grab 11 people and reach these 3 or 4 blocks, and it's the same Holy Spirit? That doesn't make any sense to me. I got to believe if the Holy Spirit is still here, that he can still do those amazing things. And we've got to give that boldness and that confidence back to our people, but it starts with you. Do you even believe it? Do you believe, or are you going to walk out of here discouraged? Well, I couldn't do that. I can't. Oh, man, that intro song, we could never come up with that at our band. You know, like, my church will never do that for me. You know, or will you walk out and go, you know what? Why not? Man, think about this. I don't know what you see when you look up on the stage. If you see flesh and blood, or do you believe that the Spirit of the living God's inside of this body? That I'm not alone up on the stage. It's not just this little Asian guy trying to convince a bunch of people, but that there's the Holy Spirit of God inside this body. The Spirit of Him who raised Jesus from the dead is now living inside of me. And now, so I'm going to be scared to speak to a bunch of church planters who agree with me and love the Word of God. And I've got the Spirit of God inside of me, that Spirit, and I'm going to be scared of these things? Or do you walk out with a boldness and go, man, no, I'm not afraid. I want this boldness. We need to pray for this boldness. We need the boldness of Elijah. Don't you love the boldness of Elijah? 450 prophets of Baal. And he goes, no, my God's going to take you down. My God's going to take you down. 450, go ahead. Let's bet on this. Let's bet. And they're dancing all day long. 400, could you do that with 450 people against you? That type of boldness where they're dancing all day screaming out and you can mock them going, oh, maybe he's going pee. You know, where's your God? You know, can you do, is it that type of boldness where they're cutting themselves and he's just mocking them, and then he gets on his knees and he goes, okay, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, show them who you are. Because I know you're there. You show them who you are. And then that fire comes down from heaven, consumes the sacrifice. And I love what it says, because it says the prophets of Baal that day go, the Lord, he is God. Those are the words. The Lord, he is God. They just keep saying, the Lord, he is God. Okay, Elijah, whatever Lord you believe in, this Yahweh, he's the real one. Your God is the real God. I love that, because they did not walk away that day going, Elijah is so funny, and he gave such a great message. You see the way they introduced him, you know, or he introduced himself? No, it had nothing to do with Elijah. They just walked away going, who's your God? Who's your God? Whoever your God is, he's the real one. Okay, I need to follow your God, your God, your God. When's the last time people have left our services going, okay, you're Jesus, he's the real one. You're Jesus. Something in that room, fire came down from heaven. So, you're Jesus, he's the real God. I'm gonna repent. I'm gonna get baptized. Give me that Spirit. That Spirit, that's the real thing. I just saw the real thing. I want the Spirit. I want whatever you have. When's that last time that happened, or were they talking? talking about you? Were they talking about other people? Or they just walk away going, the Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God, the Lord, he is God. See, my fear is that sometimes we may sound and resemble the prophets of Baal more than we resemble Elijah, where we can have all these meetings. The prophets of Baal had a great worship time that day. It was all day, all night, dancing, screaming, praying. They probably were like, wow, this is the best. You know, blood's everywhere. Yeah, you know, this is the best. This is the best. And they would have just, you know, gone home that day. Honey, we had the greatest worship service. It was all day. Look at the blood all over me, you know. We would have been hyped and going, man, we were singing. We were so loud. We started clapping, clapping, you know, yelling. It was great. But the Bible says when they were done, no one answered, no one listened. Or do our worship services look more like what Elijah did, where he got on his knees and said, God, show them who you are. And fire actually came down from heaven to where people walked away and go, okay, something real happened there. It wasn't a bunch of hype. It wasn't just a bunch of people rallying themselves and getting fired up. The Lord, he is God. I want that, don't you? I'm tired of just creating hype. For the Spirit of God to fall down on a place where people walk away going, the Lord, he is God. And I don't know what form that takes. And I don't even believe that God is a duplicator. He's a creator. And he'll create new movements with his Spirit. And it'll look different in different places. All I know is that lives will be changed in the fruit of the Spirit, the love, joy, peace, patience, kind. It'll be unbelievable. Supernatural love in your room. Supernatural peace. Those are the things we can agree on. That should be taking place. Fire from heaven. One of my favorite verses in the Bible is James 5:17. Elijah was a man just like us. Don't you love that? Elijah was a man just like us. Maybe my favorite verse, because I can walk on this stage and go, Elijah's got nothing on me. Elijah, yep, the same Elijah from back then. Yeah, if anything, I may have an advantage over him because the Holy Spirit dwells in me now. Do you walk with that type of confidence where you go, you know, Elijah was a man just like us, but he prayed, it says. And he prayed earnestly. He didn't even pray that long. He just laid it out. Everyone else was going nuts. He just quietly said, God, show him who you are. Pray with that type of faith. Elijah's got nothing on me. You really believe that about yourself? I want you to believe again in the power of the Holy Spirit. We've got people with plenty of knowledge. And they're lacking boldness, lacking confidence, but the Holy Spirit is really in them. And if you just keep looking at yourself and you stop looking at the Holy Spirit, at some point you're going to get depressed, discouraged, and you're going to quit. Because you're going to go, man, I can't do that. I'm not as smart as that. And you're looking all in the flesh when Jesus says the flesh doesn't even help. It's the Spirit that gives life. And to believe again. I'm telling you, I believe again. I believe like I've never believed before. I've seen it in my own home. From my own daughter that I had it out with. You know, my teenage daughter, my oldest. Where I just had it out with God about 9 months ago going, God, I asked for one thing selfishly. I said, don't even have my kids be born if they're not going to love you. Because I can handle anything, but I can't handle my own flesh and blood not loving you. And then that's exactly what I have. A teenage attitude, teenage tell me something I don't know. Totally going down the wrong path. I go, man, I did everything right, though. I was a good dad. I've screwed up in many, but not as a dad. I've been a good father. I'm not being arrogant. I'm just laying it out. I'm a good dad. And my wife's a good mom. And we've shown her a beautiful marriage, a beautiful family. We've shown her how God's provided all along the ways. I'm just telling you, okay? I'm not, because I'll tell you all my faults, too, but I'm not a hypocrite. And so she's seen the real thing at home. It's not like it's because, oh, I saw dad at church and he was so holy and then he comes home and he, you know, did this, did that. No. God is my witness. I'm really trying it. I'll lay out my faults, but it's not that. It's not that she doesn't have Christian friends. It's not that she doesn't have a good youth group. We got a great youth group. I wouldn't trade my youth pastor for anyone. He's the best. She's got a great counselor. You know, girl who leads her small. small group and they get together and pray together. It's like a good Christian friend. She didn't love Jesus. Oh God, what in the world? I can't do, what do you do at that point? Preach to her more? Hey, Rach, come over here. I got a better talk. Okay, I'm going to, you know, this one will get to you. What are you going to do? You got a good church, you got good friends, you got a good youth group, you got parents, you got a great Christian home, and you don't love Jesus. And you just realize at that moment, I'm going, God, this stinks. I can't do anything for her. And this is in my house. Either your Holy Spirit comes into her, and then I don't have to worry about her anymore. He'll convict her of her sin, you know, righteousness, judgment. He'll do all of that. And then if your Holy Spirit doesn't go into her, then it doesn't matter how much I do. All I can do is curb her behavior a little bit and make sure she stays a virgin. Or maybe this, or I'll lock her up, or I'll do whatever and just protect her. But it's all going to fail. Because everything hinges on one thing, whether or not your Holy Spirit comes into her and transforms her, or he doesn't, and then I can't do anything. I can't manipulate. The better band's not going to help that any. Better programming's not going to help it. It's just that one factor, and I can't control that. And on my knees, and I was, you know, 4:30 in the morning, just bawling, going, God, I'm supposed to speak to a bunch of youth pastors right now, and I don't. 6 months ago, the Holy Spirit came into my daughter, and I'm telling you, and no, I don't mean that she, you know, I laid my hands on her, and she fell over and started foaming at her mouth and chewing on the carpet. It wasn't like that, but I tell you, it was every bit as real as that. The love, the joy, the peace, the way she treats other people, man, she was, just Sunday, I come home from church, and she's on the computer sobbing, you know, just, not just bawling, you know, little tears, sobbing. I'm putting my arm around, what's going on, honey? She's got her headphones in. She goes, oh, I'm listening to these messages from the year 2000 when you preached through Revelation. I'm on my fifth one, and she's going, you know, forsaking my first love, you know, all that stuff. I'm like, wow, who are you, you know? It's a little 13-year-old, but it's been like this. You know, as a parent, you know, at first you're skeptical, like, okay, because she's telling me, no, God, the Holy Spirit's in me now. I know it's totally different. I talk to God. It's He's there. He's there. It's totally different now. I'm like, yeah. What do you want? But 6 months later, you go, no. This is weird. This is crazy. This is like biblical. I'm seeing a change in her. Then right before I left, she showed me this little thing that she wrote, like these 6 pages, you know. I'm like, what's this? She goes, oh, I was just writing about purity. I might want to write a book on purity, you know, or something. I'm like, what? You know, just like modesty, like everything. And I'm reading, I mean, this deep stuff from this 13-year-old. And she's going, yeah, I think I might call it, like, From Hoochie to Holy. I'm like, that's good, you know. It's this, you can imagine as a dad, you're just going, God, this is it. Lord, would your Holy Spirit just fall on us? May we see people who really go from hoochie to holy. And it's not because we talked them into it, but fire came down from heaven. I just want to praise God because fire came down from heaven, even in my own house. And it's starting to fall on the church. And let me tell you, I went to a conservative seminary, the Master Seminary. Okay, so just so you know, some of you go, what? You know, they take back your diploma? You know, I mean, so understand where I'm coming from theologically. Just so you know where I stand on the Word of God and everything else. And I'm just telling you, I believe 100% in the power of the Holy Spirit. And it is all about Him. And you need to believe in Him again. You know, I'm going to have the band come up, and I'm also going to have some of the leaders come forward to the front here that have some anointing oil, and they just want to pray over you. They just want to pray over you. There's nothing special about the oil, you know, but you know, James 5 talks about this, and I understand that some of it was medicinal or whatever for healing, but I just want some of you to be prayed over. And again, I'm not. You can't control what the Spirit does, and I'm not saying, oh, once they do this, you're going to start barking like a dog, and